Today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Greetings, St. John family, and welcome to today's virtual worship experience. Please be reminded that members of the finance team will be here today from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. to receive your tithes and offerings. You may also take advantage of use of our Cash App. Please be reminded that God loves a cheerful giver. And now let us be blessed with a word from our pastor, Reverend Washington.
Good morning, and let me say happy holidays to you. Welcome this morning to our virtual worship experience. It's truly a pleasure to greet you in the joy of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. I rejoice, and I hope you can rejoice with me. It's December, and it's a year to remember. As the holiday season hits us in a festive way, I am prayerfully praying that God will bless you in a fresh way. I'm excited about this word today. I'm excited because it touches my heart and it hits my own home. Listen, let's not waste another moment. Let's go directly into the Word. And first, let us have a moment of reflective prayer and certainly a moment of meditation, shall we? Thank you. I greet you in Jesus' joy. Let's go to work again in the Gospels. This month, this Advent season, I welcome you to take a journey with me in the Gospels. Today, this is important because I'm preaching my own story. Check this out. And when I say my own story, let me be specific. The story and the history of those who are called by God to serve in the kingdom of God in this way. I invite you today to turn with me to the gospel given to the author of Luke. That's Luke's gospel, chapter 1. Would you turn with me as I have my Bible? Will you get yours? Turn with me in Luke chapter 1, and let's go together. When you get to Luke chapter 1, I'm gonna give you a few moments. If you get to Luke chapter 1, I want you to turn with me to verse number 5, and there we shall begin. I share with you today from the Revised Standard Version of this New Testament Greek text. Hear God speak directly to your circumstances in this word. In the days of King Herod, who was the leader and president of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah. And he had a wife who was a daughter of the house of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Now both of them were righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and the ordinances of the Lord blamelessly. They had no children. Let me read that again. But they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in age. Now while Zechariah was serving as priest before the Lord, when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, it fell to him by lot to enter the house of the Lord, the temple of God, and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside of the house of the Lord as the incense was being prepared. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw the angel, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayers have been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have the joy and gladness, and you will rejoice with many at his birth. For he will be great before the Lord. He shall not drink any wine, nor any kind of strong drink, but he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even in his mother's womb. And he will turn many sons of Israel to their God. And he will go before him, and he will go before the one like Elisha, full of the Spirit and of power. And he will turn their hearts, the hearts of children to their fathers, and to those who are disobedient, he will turn from the disobedient of the just, to make them ready for the Lord, to make them ready for the people of the Lord." And Zechariah said to the angel, How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." And the angel of the Lord said to him, "I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and I was sent to you to speak to you, to bring you this good news. And behold, now you will be silent and unable to speak
until the day that these things have come to pass, because you did not believe in my word, which will be fulfilled in their own time. And the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they wondered at his delay in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak to them, and they discerned that he had seen a vision in the temple, and he made signs to them and remained silent. And when his time of service ended, he went home. After these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she hid herself, saying, "Thus the Lord has done to me in the days when he looked on me to take away the reproach of people." Amen.
I want to share from the subject simply today, the preacher and his wife, a story of Christmas. The preacher and his wife. I want to share with you that this is a very powerful, powerful story. It's one that I know and one that I have often moved fast past without really giving it any attention. But today I want to pause with you and talk with you about what this preacher and his wife can share with us through the powerful words of God. I want you to know that I am a third generation preacher, and I've seen preaching a long time in my family. My father was a pastor and preacher. My grandfather, I have uncles that are preaching and an aunt that's a preacher. And certainly I know that the power of preaching in the family of God is a unique experience. But today I want to testify to you that everything is not always hunky-dory and fine in the preacher's house, that the preacher actually has trouble in his own house sometimes, and you need to know that preachers and their families are not perfect. I hear some of you saying, "Oh, we know that. We see the man of God or the woman of God struggling to make things happen. We understand they have faults, and we see them more than they acknowledge." That may be true. You do, because we're often before you in ways that you aren't before us. However, what I am getting at today is this truth. The devil loves a preacher's family. I mean, if the devil can get in and destroy and break and cause havoc in the family of God, who are for those who are called according to God to lead God's people, to bring the word to God, then the devil is doing a great job to destroy, distort, and disturb God's man or woman in their rightful place. Let me make it live for you. Can you imagine getting on a plane, or when you do get on an airplane, you see the cockpit crew, you see the pilot and the crew that help the pilot guide the plane. You have no idea what that pilot and that crew have gone through before you get to that point. You have absolutely no idea what's on their mind. You have no idea what they've emotionally struggled with, what they financially are dealing with, or the fight that they've just had with their family or their children. You have absolutely no idea. All you know is that it is their job to guide that plane that you're on to a destination place. And brothers and sisters, you've got to be careful and understand that if that pilot is having a rough day, a bad day, he or she who is a pilot can actually have a distortive moment in flying, and all hell could break loose. I want you to understand, come close, that if the pastor, the preacher, the man or woman who is God's servant in your stead spiritually has those kinds of days, you don't know what kind of driving or flying they will do when you're on board that ship. That's why you pray for them. That's why you keep them lifted, encourage them, because whether you like to acknowledge it or not, they are feeding your soul and preparing you for a place that you've never gone before, but that is real and that you want to go to. My brothers and sisters, in the Gospel of Luke, we have a preacher, a pastor by the name of Zechariah, and his wife, Elizabeth, who are, according to the text, old, aged, and should be preparing for retirement. We are aware that it is Zach's time to go and serve God. And I want you to know without further ado that Zach is about to have an experience that he will never forget. The angel of the Lord comes to them, family, and shares with them, according to Luke's gospel, that the Lord has heard their prayers. And while they're serving, we get to discover that they've been praying for something that has not come. Let me share with you that in this season of Advent, in this moment of Advent, you've got to understand, and I've got to understand, what God has packaged for us in this particular text. They've been praying for something that has not come. And they've been praying, family, not for one day, not for a year, not for 6 months or a month, but they've been praying for some years, and it's not taken place. And according to Luke, it has been stated in Luke's gospel that they haven't had a child, family, because Elizabeth is barren. Now, I know many of you have heard and understand that barrenness is actually something that has been linked to a woman or a man having issues with sin in their life. But we are clear, family, that the Word of God tells us in Luke's gospel in chapter 1 that they are blameless, that they have followed God in every way possible, that they have been committed to God and have not been the cause of anyone losing faith in God. So that issue of whether it's a sin or a disobedient act that's caused barrenness in their marriage and family is not true. Let me share with you this word today, that in the season of waiting, in the season of Advent, in the season where you are waiting for God to give you a breakthrough and your family a break, and in a season where you're looking for God to deliver and set you free, I want you to know we can learn a valuable lesson from the preacher and his wife. How and what does the preacher and his wife have to share with us? I'm glad you've asked. I want you to know that when you are caused by God to wait, in your season, when God is not answering the prayers that you've prayed, when God is making you wait, when you are having, watch this, to be patient, and when you're having to endure something, I want you to know that the pastor, the preacher, and his wife, Zach and Elizabeth, have a word for us. The first thing they reveal to us is that when God causes us to wait in a particular season, what I want you to see is how they bless our life. Whenever God causes us to wait, we need to check, family, our faithfulness to God. Elizabeth and Zach are still faithful, even though their prayers have not been answered. How many of you can testify that you remain faithful and consistent and keep the commandments of God when your prayers have not been answered? If we are honest, family, we need to acknowledge that it's hard to stay faithful to God, to give to the kingdom of God, to serve God, to sing for God, to play for God, to actually keep committed to God and God's church when our prayers have not been answered. It's hard to preach the word of God when you've prayed for things to happen and they haven't taken place. That's when faith has to kick in. That's when you lean not to what you see, but you lean to what you understand and you remember what God has promised you. I'm already feeling good right now. The truth of the matter is, you ought to be able to shout with Elizabeth and Zach that even though God hasn't answered your prayer, as God had not answered them in years, family, they remain faithful to the call of God on their life. The preacher and his wife are teaching us in the season of COVID, in the pandemic, that you've got to remain faithful to God even though you can't gather in God's house. Even though you can't worship in a way that you want to worship, you've got to remain faithful because God is still good. God is still God, and God is still preparing something for you and yours, even when you can't see it. They remain faithful, family, and I've got to challenge you, as I challenge myself this morning, to remain faithful to the call of God on our life, even when our prayers are not answered. Zach and Elizabeth, they are a team, and they remain faithful even though God has stripped them and not answered their prayers. It would be difficult for us to remain faithful even when God is blessing, because what they want most, God has kept from them. Has anybody ever felt that way? I mean, let me see what time. Has anybody ever felt that God has kept you from getting what you really want? I've been there. And matter of fact, some of you may be there right now. The breakthrough, the deliverance, the change, the hope, the dream, the up at night experiences, the transfers, whatever God has not granted yet, I want you to know if you remain faithful, if you remain committed, if you remain where God desires you to be, it's not because you've done something wrong. It may be that God is working on your behalf. Check this out, family. They have not had God answer their prayers, but they remain faithful. They're still going to church. They're still committed to working in the kingdom of God, even though the God they serve has not answered their prayer. In essence, they are not conditional Christian. They are not conditional followers of God. And we have some very temperamental and some conditional people who claim to love God. If you love Him, you got to stay committed. You got to stay connected, even when your prayers are not heard according to you and not answered according to God. I want to pause right now and not only ask that you examine your faithfulness to God's call on your life, but secondly, they reveal something more to us. Let's take a look. What could they reveal to us, secondly, beloved? The word says that they kept the ordinances, so they were faithful, even though they were barren. You missed your shout moment. That even though you are barren in some area in your life, that God still allows you and gives you, watch this, productivity in the job you currently have. You missed your shout moment. You may not be where you want to be in career. You may not be where you want to be in relationship, but God will never allow every area of our life to not be productive because one area is not productive. I'll shout for you because God is able to keep one area in our life barren, but yet bless us in abundance in other ways. You may not progress at work, but your family continues to multiply. You may not progress at home and get the affection and the love you desire, but guess what? You're being elevated at work. You may not have what you want to have and drive what you want to drive, but the Lord is opening doors for you in ways that other people are jealous and desire to. Even though God doesn't answer their prayer, God still is blessing them in abundance in other areas. And that's a word for you, that even though God isn't blessing you where you want God to bless you, God is blessing you in some parts of your life. That's why the old saints would say, you can't hurry God, you just have to wait. God is doing some great things, some unseen things. If you can just take a moment in this Advent season and look at God, do what only God can do. Look, she's barren, which means he's barren. He doesn't have a son, he doesn't have a daughter, and neither does she, but yet they are serving God, and yet God is answering some prayers that they don't know of yet. Text says that while this is important, I'm gonna pause, this is real good to me, that while they are serving, it came time for him to do something important. It's his season. Even though it's barren, it's still his season. I want you to understand something, that when God causes us to wait and we are in a season of waiting for God's will to be done in our life, never forget that God is still active in your life. God may not be answering a prayer that you desire, but God is still active. Listen, God's active, and I'm going to take my seat after this. God's active in their life because the priest, the preacher man, is now called to do something that's an honor and a privilege that doesn't come but once or twice in the lifetime of a priest. Hear me. He's going to light incense in the temple, in the holiest of holies. Everybody doesn't get that privilege. He's an old man, which means his time had not yet come. But here is the important act that we can see God at work. God allows him, watch this, to align his serving family, watch this, in the midst of when God's will and providential grace is on the way. Let me see if I can break it down and make it live. There comes a time in our life where our timetable doesn't fit God's, but yet God allows us to align our out of order timetable with what God has in store for us and God's glory. Let me see. It's not a Chronos moment, it's a Kairos moment. God works in seasons and not calendar years. And what America might want to recognize is that we may be in a season right now where God is purging us and preparing us for a new season. Listen, Elizabeth and Zach are barren, but he's in the season where God is about to elevate him. So watch this. God can use him, family, get this, to produce something for God's will. What do you see? That God can call you out of barrenness in one area into a season of blessedness in another. So you could be in two seasons. You missed your shout moment. You could be in a blessed season and you could be in a barren season at the same time. And God's still making ways and actively moving in your life. Matter of fact, that's where some of us are now. We're blessed on one hand, but we're barren on the other hand. And we're wondering, how can God have us blessed on one hand and barren on the other hand? I'm sick with fever on one hand, but I'm blessed to have a family on the other. I'm blessed to have a job, but I'm dealing with issues and struggles and strains. I'm going through at the house, but I'm blessed at the workplace. I don't have what I want, but I'm so glad to have something. I'm blessed and I'm barren. You missed your shout moment. Elizabeth and Zach are blessed but barren. How? Because his number has come up. And since his number is up, whoo, family, it's amazing how God's will trump our barrenness. Here it is, and I'm going to take my seat. They're barren, but now they're in line for the breakthrough. And sometimes, even family, this, when we are in line for a breakthrough, we have to keep going so that we don't miss the breakthrough timing. I know you're tired. I know you're exhausted. I know you don't want to go any further. I know that you want to stay where you are in the bed and not move. But I've come to tell you on behalf of God prophetically, get up. Go do it one more time. It might be now where the angel of God is coming at the moment you're doing what you're called to do, that you get your word, your breakthrough to keep you going and to know that you're in the season where God wants you to be. That's all I'm saying today, family. It's heavy, but it's righteous. That even though you feel like giving up, don't you waver. Get up, get out of your bed of affliction, get out of your bed of sickness, and keep going, because it might be the day that the Lord has sent his angel to tell you you're in good space, you're in good company, and the breakthrough is on the way. It's around the corner. And matter of fact, Zach learns the breakthrough is right now. I'm gonna close. Everybody has seen this movie, The Preacher's Wife. Yeah, gotta go. In The Preacher's Wife, I want you to realize one thing. In The Preacher's Wife, Courtney Vance is struggling because he doesn't think God hears him. He's struggling because he doesn't believe that God is the one that's really hearing him, because he's failing in his mind and stumbling in his mind and not being productive in his mind to raise the money that's necessary to fix the boiler. But I've come to announce to you that God was working even when he felt barren. His wife, Whitney, had fallen in some ways that she shouldn't have, but that's all right, because even when we don't do what we should do, even when we're open to things that we shouldn't be open, the Lord has a way of working our vulnerability into his glory. And guess what happens in The Preacher's Wife? In the midst of a preacher about to give up and resign, in the midst of a wife about to try to cry for her husband, wondering if they were going to make it, God strangely helps them by sending an angel. And I hear you saying, angels are very real. And if you look around, family, you'll see your angel of the Lord waiting for you this season. Abraham had an angel. Isaac had an angel. You have an angel. And Zach, the preacher, and Elizabeth had an angel. And I've come to tell you, the angel is bringing that word for you and for me, that God is letting us know that it's just about the season of breakthrough and deliverance from being blessed and barren to being completely in order. I can't wait till next week, because there's so much more to unpack in this scripture. I can't wait to come back to you next week to preach what God has laid on my heart, the lessons from the preacher and his wife. What do I need you to know? That when God's got you in a season of waiting, stay faithful to your call.
When God's got you in a season of waiting, remember, you could be barren and blessed at the same time, which means you could be in two seasons. And God will send a word to you to let you know that your season of two is about to become a season of one. I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. God is on your side, God is on our side, and God is in the blessing business. Listen, I want to extend an invitation to you. This month, I need you to help us bless the kingdom of God in every way possible. Try this month God's way, tithing, supporting the ministry of God, and yes, family, extending your hospitality to people that you don't even know. God loves you, and so do I. And I wish you, family, you got it. Peace, I wish you love, and I wish you some great soul. Have a great day. Bye.